You'd never know it, but there's a side of quarrying nobody ever sees. When the sun sets and the crews leave, when the gates lie locked and the site sits silent and still, quarries offer up their secrets to those who know where to look. Welcome to the secret life of quarries. Before raw stone can become something more, it must be pulled from the grip of the ground. Centuries ago, the masons who built this cathedral extracted countless tons of rock from the earth, moving every piece by hand, hauling and breaking and placing and carving each stone as it was needed. Today, with the strength of our machines and the alchemy of our industry, the typical quarry moves enough stone to build such a place every month. How is this achieved? That's the secret of extraction. There are two ways to get rock out of the ground. Rip it up, or blow it up. Ripping is relatively quiet and works well where blasting is too noisy, too risky, or too expensive. But pulling stone up piece by piece is far slower than blasting thousands of tons at once, leading to lower production rates. Most quarries blast, as it's far quicker and more cost-effective than ripping. But blasts aren't always popular with the neighbours. Blasting explosives also come at a cost, are hard to obtain, are riddled with red tape, and are decidedly dangerous to deal with. Then there's the issue of balance. Too big a bang and we risk demolishing both our profit margin and the materials we're after. Too little and we leave huge unbroken rocks that are hard to load, hard to move, and impossible to crush without being broken down further. All of which costs time and money. Done properly, though, blasting paves the way for serious production, allowing us to awaken the real monsters and make the most of massive mouths and bigger bellies. Because at the core of every quarry, there's an even bigger beast, and it's always hungry. The crusher isn't just at the heart of the quarry. It's at the heart of production, performance, and cost per ton. Because an overfed crusher wastes time, money, and fuel, while an underfed crusher eats into production and profits. So it's no exaggeration to say that the real secret of extraction is to start at the crusher and think backwards. How best to feed a hungry crusher? Which tool do we trust to fill truck after truck after truck with the stone it demands? It's wheel loader versus excavator, and they're very different animals. Where both weather and environment are kind, nothing moves material like a wheel loader. On the flat, nothing matches its straight line speed and solidity. And it has by far the biggest bite. The wheel loader keeps its environment clean, can move effortlessly from rock face to rock face to rock face. In fact, in the right conditions and operating completely independently, can feed its haulers faster than any other machine. And, in the right circumstances, can even feed the crusher directly. But on uneven ground, or in a tight space, the wheel loader cannot compete with the excavator. Agility, stability, and the longest of long necks allows the excavator to thrive in rough, unstable environments. And with tank-like treads and a 360-degree field of motion, an excavator stands where it likes and looks where it chooses. Most comfortable perched on higher ground, excavators forego mobility and speed for reach, agility, and sure-footedness. So, when pace matters most of all, when ground is even, and when faces are wide and spaces are open, then we need the wide bite and fleetness of foot of the wheel loader. But when faced with tight spaces, hard-to-reach faces, overly large rock, or uneven ground, we must trust the longer neck and firmer grip of the excavator. It sounds so simple. It isn't. Machine choice doesn't stop at the rock face. We have to consider the vehicles being loaded, because beyond the need to feed the crusher, there's also no point pairing a wheel loader that can pour 10 tons a minute with a truck that can only hold 5. We have to consider the skills, costs, and numbers of available operators, because even the most advanced loaders can't drive themselves. And we have to decide between having many small machines, where machine and operator costs are high, but one machine breaking down isn't a disaster, or having fewer, large machines, where even a single machine going down can threaten the entire operation. And no matter the fleet, it must meet the crusher's demands. We even have to decide whether to buy new machines at all. Used and rebuilt machines have their uses, and new wheel loaders and excavators come at a cost. Sometimes the best approach for extraction is simply to trust the same machines we used for overburden removal. Finally, new machines or not, what matters more than size of mouth or length of neck is type of teeth. Dinosaur or digger, we can tell a lot about a creature by studying its teeth. Ground engaging tools, or GET, are no different, with shape, size, and sharpness all contributing hugely to a machine's performance. Longer, thinner tips are perfect for penetrating hard surfaces, while wider, thicker ends are better suited to softer materials. Wearing matters too. Use too blunt a tip on too hard a surface, and we markedly increase the effort needed to break up the material, pushing up fuel usage and pulling down productivity. In fact, picking the right ground engaging tools and knowing when to replace them can be the difference between making a profit and just making a mess. And if the secret of getting the most out of the ground is to pick the perfect machine, the secret of getting the most out of the machine is to pick the perfect human. Done properly, loading is a dance. Both partners must move around one another, anticipating, matching, always in step, always in time. Taller partners must make the most of their reach. Shorter partners, their timing. Every movement, every moment matters. And over the course of a year, such economy of movement could spin real savings. Remarkably, this level of coordination and cooperation can now be achieved with an empty cab, thanks to long-range remote control technology, allowing quarries to safely harness the skills of expert operators half a world away. Remote or in person, in sync or not, the key question with loading is, how much? Overload a hauler and every moving part must work harder, take more strain and ultimately degrade sooner, pushing costs up and taking key machines out of action. But underload a truck and we undo all our good work, increasing the number of cycles and burning through time, money and fuel. The solution, as always, is to work a little smarter. Many modern machines come equipped with load sensors, letting us know precisely when a truck has had its fill. And as strange as it seems, amidst all this mass and movement, there are moments of almost surreal stillness. Whenever the crusher is far away, or when there aren't enough trucks to fill, loaders must sit patiently and wait. And yet many operators choose to keep their machines awake, burning through fuel and reducing its life, value, and usefulness. But with the help of a few sensors and circuits, we can gain an overview of every machine in the quarry, helping minimize wasted time and effort to give us the best possible cost per ton. So now we know how stone from beneath the earth is brought to the surface. But how does simple crushed stone become something more? Where does rock become something more than raw material? Well, that involves the secrets of hauling. And that's a tale for another day.